Dear viewers, we are continuing with the tools of monetary policy, and we are going to the next tool, which is selective credit control. The selective credit control. When we talk of selective credit control, dear viewers, we mean a situation where the government, through the central bank, identifies vital sectors of the economy and they advance credit accordingly. As you hear the word selective, they select those sectors which are not in luxurious activities and they advance credit. So during periods of too much money in circulation or during inflation, the central bank advises commercial banks or directs commercial banks to advance credit or to give out loans to selected few sectors of the economy which are vital, such that too much money in saturation can be checked on. They say now, for example, give loans only to agriculture, because agriculture is the most important sector in the Ugandan economy, for example. They select those sectors which must receive loans, in other words. But during the period of a deflation, when there is no money in circulation, now the government, through the central bank, advises commercial banks or tells commercial banks, please give out loans to whoever comes for them. That's how the money is increased in circulation. So that's how the tool of selective credit control is used. Dear viewers, another tool is the margin requirement. The marginal requirement. Many people confuse this with the legal reserve requirement. But when we talk of marginal requirement, dear viewers, we mean the difference in the value of collateral security required and the amount of the loan. That difference, if you want to borrow this much, what is the value of collateral required? That's what we mean by margin requirement. So you find that during periods of inflation or during periods of too much money in circulation, the margin requirement is raised. You find that if you want a loan, let's say, of 1 million, in order to discourage you from getting a loan, they will say this loan of 1 million should be, you should pledge collateral of value of 10 million. You see, they are now trying to discourage you from borrowing, because a person who comes to borrow 1 million may not have property worth 10 million. So in doing that, they check the amount of money in saturation. But during a deflation, whereby the government wishes now to increase money in circulation, this marginal requirement is lowered. They say if you want 1 million, even there is no need of collateral. Or they say we need collateral, let's say over 100,000. And this encourages borrowing, and that increases the amount of money in circulation. Also, we have another tool, which is direct action. Direct action. Direct action. Direct action. Direct action. Here the government intervenes directly in the process of borrowing and lending. So during the period of inflation where there is too much money in circulation, the government intervenes and tells commercial banks, please stop lending to the public. The government now here through the central bank intervenes directly in the process of lending and borrowing by commercial banks. But when there is a deflation, the central bank will now direct commercial banks that please lend money to the public, and this increases money in circulation. Then we also have what we call moral suasion. Moral suasion. Here the central bank keeps on persuading. This one is also is all about mutual understanding. They persuade, they try to convince the commercial banks that in case there is too much money in circulation, the central bank will advise commercial bank, please, there is too much money in circulation, don't lend to the public. But when there is a deflation, in periods of deflation, now the central bank comes to commercial bank and say, please, we are advising you to lend money to the public so that a deflation can be controlled. So, dear viewers, those are tools that are employed by the central bank to regulate money in saturation. Dear viewers, we shall find out that in the process of implementing these tools, in the process of making the monetary policy operate, there are some limitations. So, limitations of monetary policy. What limits the monetary policy from operating effectively as far as credit control is concerned? Limitations of monetary policy. Limitations of monetary policy. Number one, we have excessive liquidity among commercial banks. And that limitation renders the use of the bank rate. It makes the use of bank rate useless, because if commercial banks have excessive credit, it means they will not be interested in borrowing from the central bank. So it means even when the central bank raises the bank rate, the commercial banks are not affected, because they have their own money from which they can lend to the public. So excessive liquidity among commercial banks is one of the limitations of monetary policy, because you find that some of the tools will not work effectively when commercial banks have a lot of money. Number two, dominance of foreign commercial banks. Dominance of foreign commercial banks. Dear viewers, you will find that in a developing economy like Uganda, we have many commercial banks from abroad. Those commercial banks are very, very difficult to be controlled by the central bank, because for them, they report directly to the central banks of the countries where they come from. So when the central bank of here, like Bank of Uganda, puts in place a tool, these foreign commercial banks do not follow. And since they are the ones that dominate this economy, it becomes very hard for this monetary policy to be a success. Then another limitation is high liquidity preference among the public. So you find that many people are having money in cash. In other words, they desire to have money in cash. So for the government, it employs tools knowing that the money is in the commercial bank when people are having money in their houses. So the government employs a tool to work on the money which is not in the banking sector. People are having their money in pillowcases, in pots. So the effort of the government through these monetary tools cannot effectively work when much money is in the hands of the public. Also, the ignorance of the population about these monetary policies and the services offered by commercial banks. Like, many people do not understand how the open market operation operates. So people not understanding the buying and selling of treasury bills and bonds make these monetary tools ineffective. Then unfavorable external influence such as IMF. You find they have some conditions like credit squeeze. So meaning that these international organizations can bring in policies that may not be favorable based on the current economic situation. You find there is a deflation, but IMF is saying reduce money in circulation. So some of these tools may not effectively operate when there is high degree of external influence. Then also the underdeveloped money and capital markets. These markets where government securities are bought and sold are not developed, on top of not being understood by the masses. They are not developed. So the buying and selling of securities like bonds and treasury bills, they don't effectively operate because these markets are not developed, and on top of that, people do not understand them. Then also the rampant corruption by bank officials. Here you find the central bank is saying don't lend money, but people, these bank officials who are in charge of loans, they get bribes and end up giving out money when it is not needed at that time. Also, poor distribution of commercial banks. Most of them are up and best. So the money which is in the banking sector is the up and best money. While your people in the village, they are having money in cash in their houses. Therefore, when the government employs these tools, they work only on urban places, ignoring the villages. Okay? So those are some of the factors that limit the effective operation of monetary policy. And dear viewers, that brings us to the end of money and banking. Meet you in the next episode.